dağlar arasına gizlenmiş, üstü bulutlarla kaplı, taş evleri ve ağaçsız bahçeleriyle uzaktan bir kayalığı andıran köye, güneş batmak üzereyken elinde uzun asasıyla siyah hırkalı bir gezgin geldi. Önce duvarları, sonra köpekleri, ardından duvar dibinde oturan yaşlıları selamladı. Adını soranlara "Ben peygamberim" diye karşılık verdi. Evine davet edenleri nazikçe geri çevirdi. Uzun yoldan yayan geldiği için çıplak ayakları yaralan ve bastığı yerde kan izleri bırakan gezgine ısrar ettiler, yemek sundular. O su içmekle yetindi ve yumuşak sesiyle "Benim peygamberliğime kim inanırsa onun konuğu olur, onun yemeğini yerim" dedi. Çocuklar meraklı gözlerle bakarken yaşlılar güldü. Gezgin geceyi dışarıda geçerdi. Sabahleyin peygamberlikten söz etti ve bir mucize getirmesini isteyen köylülere tutkuyla seslendi. Kalbi yansıtan söz en büyük mucizedir. Başka mucize aramayın, söze inanın. Kimse inanmadı. Gezgin o gece de dışarıda kaldı. Su içti, duvar dibinde köpeklerle yan yana uyudu. Ertesi gün konuşurken yaşlılarla birlikte bu kez çocuklar da güldü ona. Gezgin sakindi. "Şu duvar konuşsa" dedi. "Bana inanmayan sizler duvara inanır mısınız?" Hep bir ağızdan "Evet inanırız" dediler. Siyah hırkalı, donu yamalı, ayakları çıplak bir adamdı Gezgin. Elindeki asası, omzundaki heybesi dışında mülkü yoktu. Dönüp duvara seslendi. "Ey duvar! Yaşlılara ve çocuklara benim peygamber olduğumu söyle." Köylüler inanmadıkları halde sessizce beklediler. Duvar dile geldi. "Yalan, bu adam peygamber değil."
I'm joined in Istanbul by Burhan Sanmaz. He is the author of 4 novels, and they are translated into 40 different languages. We would like to speak about Istanbul, how it's depicted in novels, and also in reality and today. I'd like to ask you first, there are many novels, many artistic works that depict Istanbul. How is Istanbul depicted as a city in literature?
In literature, we mean Andalusia in Turkey mainly. And we can say that more or less in the last 20 years our fiction writing has focused on Istanbul and had a picture of Istanbul in two colors. The one color is Western, the other color is called Eastern. And Istanbul then seen as the meeting point of those two different cultures and colors. I think now in 21st century, now, another approach is emerging, that is seeing Istanbul again into different colors, but it's not divided as East and West. It's divided as underground and overground Istanbul, because underground lives has got a totally different kind of life from life that lived overground. And in Istanbul now we can say people are suffering, people are in pain, people are frustrated, people have hope, and some people having fun. They are all together. They are in the same city, and we call the city Istanbul.
This brings me to your novel entitled Istanbul, Istanbul. Why are there two Istanbuls in this title?
When I started to write this novel, I wanted to have two different Istanbul in my novel, and those two different parts should be one underground, the other one overground. I'm telling stories of people who are underground, living in dark, in pain, and the story of other people living on surface with hope and with the appreciation of the beauty of Istanbul. And the combination of those two different spheres in Istanbul made my novel.
And later you have a novel titled Labyrinth. And in this novel, Istanbul is depicted as a labyrinth. Could you tell me about it?
I think in Labyrinth, I didn't divide the city into two different parts as west or east or underground and overground. And I had a single frame and with so many different lines. In every line, you can find a different street, different road, a different square. And when you dive into that city, you will walk through streets as if you are walking through the history, as if you are walking through time, and you are walking through different social groups, social classes. And you realize that Istanbul has got so many different ages, eras, times, spaces, social backgrounds, but in the end, the frame is single.
And what do you see today looking at Istanbul?
Oh gosh, okay. Today, Istanbul gives me two feelings, I think. The first is the power of her beauty, still shining. And the second part is sadness. The sadness that we are ruining this beautiful city. Why we, I mean, the citizen of Istanbul, or the citizen of this country, mainly political power, mainly big corporations, rich companies, they are mistreating the city. They are destroying it. But as a simple person here, as an ordinary citizen in Istanbul, I'm also responsible for this. Because I see it, if I don't stop it, then I'm part of that evil. So I know this is beautiful, but if I want to appreciate and being appreciated in this city, then I have to fight to protect the beauty.
And lastly, would you think that a city has a soul? And for example, today that we are disturbing the soul of the city.
I think we have to believe it. The cities like Istanbul have a very unique soul. Their soul is more powerful than our insane heart. We don't treat the city in a good way. And we do very bad things to her. But on the other hand, we see that the city is resisting, still keeping her beauty against all kind of evil coming from humankind.
Thank you very much.